In the hot seat this evening is Paul Stewart from Plexus, and I've been waiting a long time to get Paul back in studio. So, Paul, appreciate your time. We're talking this evening about the Plexus RAFI Enhanced SA Strategy Fund B, and I'm going to begin with asking you for your objective on this fund.
Great. Well, good evening to everybody, and nice to see you again, too. The objective of the portfolio is to outperform the all-share index, the FTSE JSE all-share index, and we would try to do that over a rolling three-year period, and that would be the primary objective. And our objective, we think, given the strategy and the way the fund is constructed, that we should deliver 2-3% net outperformance of the index over time.
Looking at the fact that the fund was began on the 20th of August 2007, are you meeting your objective to this point?
The since inception numbers are slightly behind the index. It is relatively time dependent. The four-year number, we are ahead of the index, and we actually were ahead of the index quite nicely up until about May of this year, and we saw quite a strong run in some of the large cap stocks, which obviously we lag a little bit. But we're not too worried about that. We think that over the sort of rolling seven-year periods, which is the full business cycle which we talk about, we think that the fund will actually deliver, and historic data does suggest that. So we think the fund is pretty much on track where we would expect it to be given the stage in the cycle we are right now. And perhaps in the discussion this evening, the explanation will become a little bit clearer.
Paul, just looking at the metrics that you look at to perform your investment strategy and what you look at in a company when you're looking to buy something, just can you go through some of those metrics and then also perhaps give us some examples of how those metrics are being practiced in your fund at the moment?
Sure, great. So this is an index fund, and the idea of the portfolio is to create a portfolio of shares that is devised not by the size of the company in the index, i.e. the market capitalization, which is the way most indices are constituted, but we use other non-price correlated factors to do that. And the factors that we use are operating earnings, cash flows, turnover, book value, and dividends. And those four factors we take straight out of the income statement or the balance sheet. We look at them on a regular basis. The index is reconstituted on a quarterly basis. And we're looking for the companies that have got the best values on those four factors. So we're looking for stocks that are showing good turnover, good cash flows, a high level of book value, and good dividend payers. And the constant reconstitution of those types of shares give you a portfolio that looks different to a market capitalization weighted index and hopefully outperforms it over time. The history suggests that this is this is quite feasible. So to look at our top holdings, for example, the largest single stock in the index is Billiton, which is its weight in our index is not too dissimilar to what it is in the all share index at about just over 12%.
Paul, just before we continue talking about the stocks, the fact is that the portfolio generally consists of around about 40 stocks, and that comes from the 100 stocks with the largest market cap in the South African universe. Is that correct?
That's correct. So we're choosing 40 using the fundamental factors which I've just described, the turnover, operating earnings, book value, and dividends. So you're really trying to refine, out of that universe of shares, you're really trying to refine the stocks that have got the best fundamental value as measured by our methodology. Obviously, fundamental analysts that work for active management, fund management companies and stockbrokers would have their own fundamental analysis. But those are the four factors which we use to dissolve or to diffuse the 40 stocks we select out of that universe of the top 100.
And then I interrupted you on the BHP Billiton story, because I think there are probably a number of viewers going, oh, she stopped him when he was telling us why BHP is their top holding at 12.2%. Well, that was according to your 31st of August fact sheet.
Correct. So I think the real issue is that Billiton scores pretty highly on all four of those factors, and it is quite an unusual scenario given that it's a big stock. You typically find in these fundamental index type strategies the very large stocks tend to be downweighted in the index, and in fact Anglo American is our largest. It is a holding in the portfolio where we've got a negative active bet of about 5.5% against Anglo. So the fundamental index strategy at the moment prefers Billiton to Anglo's, and that's because on all four of those metrics, Billiton is showing us significantly better valuation. Similarly, on the retailers, we've got both ShopRite and Pick n Pay in the portfolio, but Pick n Pay has recently been upweighted. It's actually the same, this pretty much the same weight as ShopRite, but it's a bigger weighting in our portfolio relative to Pick n Pay's weighting in the All Share Index, for example. So these factors tend to actually throw up the value type of stocks. And as such, a fundamental index has actually been dubbed a value index.
Kevin is smiling in studio here, factors, Paul, because just a moment ago he was setting out the investment case behind Pick n Pay, and I know he agrees wholeheartedly with that upping of your weighting in Pick n Pay. Kevin, just reiterate your sentiments. It's good to get consensus on stocks on the desk.
Yeah, just the numbers were out today. They were terrible numbers and the stock was up. I think that shows that a lot of the bad news is already priced in, and I think you've got plenty of time, but I think it's one you have to look at going forward. It's very similar to, I think, Telkom at the moment. We don't hold Telkom at the moment, but there's definitely things that we are changing within the environment for us to look far more closely at and perhaps take some exposure at some point in the future, and it's the same thing with Pick n Pay.
Paul, let's throw forward to Old Mutual. It's also one of the stocks that you hold as one of your top 10 holdings in this particular fund. The rationale behind that holding?
In fact, at the moment, Old Mutual is the largest active bet, positive active bet in the portfolio, followed by Telkom, both at a 3% overweight position relative to their weight in the All Share Index. And once again, it's exactly the same. It's exactly the same rationale. You know, Old Mutual's been through through a rough time in the last couple of years. The share price has oscillated pretty wildly as the market has tried to digest whether or not the foreign businesses are going to be successful, and you know, Old Mutual trying to find its place in the local market. But you know, this is a very valuable business. It's a very valuable brand. There is a reasonable amount of cash in the business, and the operational performance is actually starting to improve. It's one of those stocks which is not widely loved by the investing community, but it is one of those stocks which, you know, on a reversion to mean basis, is probably going to, it's got quite a lot of upside potential built into it if you've provided you've got the patience to sit out and wait for it to unlock that value over time. This is also true of Telkom, of course, and we're not surprised to see a foreign player coming in and potentially, and I'm obviously talking about SK Telecom from Korea here, taking an active interest. Whether the transaction goes through or not, it remains to be seen. But we're not surprised by that, and it's actually happened recently. A couple of years ago, we were one of the few fund managers that actually had a weighting in Massmart of any significant size, and obviously, you know, the rest is history.
Kevin's ears have picked up on the Telkom story, because this is something that we've debated aggressively in the Business Tonight studio. And Kevin, do you agree, considering that we had consensus on Pick n Pay, do you think that Telkom could be a value unlock story?
I think it is. As I mentioned, though, we don't have exposure at this point. At the moment, we hold Vodacom. Vodacom is a superb operator and paying a very handsome dividend yield at the moment. But the investment case for Telkom is that it's underperformed for so long. The market has derived lots of lists of why it just won't perform at any point in the future. And you can almost forget about it as an investor, and we see that a lot. So whenever people are starting to say that we don't think Telkom will ever be able to perform again, that's when our ears perk up and we like to get into it. And it's the same case with Pick n Pay.
Paul, do you believe that all the bad news is in Telkom's share price at the moment?
Bronwyn, I would never be so bold as to say all the bad news is in anything, but I think it's certainly, you know, one of the main reasons why Telkom is upweighted in the index is because of its book value, and you know, Telkom's asset rich you know, the valuation just on the network which they own is significant. And you know, I've always felt that at some point in time, if the telecom management can't get that right, you know, some foreign entity will probably get it right. And obviously, you know, the government shareholding and the PRC shareholding in Telkom is always a hurdle. But once again, if the value can't be unlocked, I think eventually somebody will come with a suit with a strong enough deal to actually unlock that value. And certainly, you know, from a book value point of view, we think that there's significant value there.
I think Paul's very wise in saying you actually never know when all the bad news is accounted for. The news is dynamic, it's coming out all the time, and for you to think that, well, that's it is very brave. But Paul, just coming back to you, the fund, does your mandate allow you to have cash? And if so, what is your weighting to cash at the moment?
Okay, so this is an index fund, and we only have a very small cash buffer in the portfolio to pay for disinvestments and things like that when necessary. We never take the cash weighting much above 0.5%. So this is a full
100% equity domestic portfolio.
The other very important factor is that we are only allowed to invest in South African listed stocks. So this is a pure South African portfolio, no inward listeds, and relative to the peer group, you know, for example, we aren't allowed to hold BAT in the portfolio because of its inward listed status, and that's obviously been a significant hamstring for the portfolio relative to other general equity funds over the last year or two that could hold BAT. It's been a good performer, you know. So we've, but as long as investors need to realise that this is a pure South African equity portfolio. There's no foreign holdings, and there's very little cash. So it's one of those. It's an equity building block, I think, for people's put in the sock and keep it there for the long run. It's not a trading portfolio. It's a long-term core equity South African portfolio.
Paul, before we go, and we are running out of time, just very quickly, in terms of the risks to the domestic equity story, what would you say is the biggest external risk right now? Is it the Eurozone? Is it the US? Is it China? We saw those third quarter GDP numbers out yesterday at 9.1%, still very robust, but down from the 9.7% that we saw in the first quarter. So what would you say is the biggest external risk?
That's a great question, Bronwyn, and I can tell you from, and this is my opinion, the one risk that I think keeps me awake at night is a default in the European banking system by one of the major banks, which could be brought on by the defaulting of not just Greece, I think that's in the market, but how quickly that would spread to some other more intrinsically important European countries, and then into the periphery, then into the core of Europe, into perhaps one of the big German or French banks. I think that would be a calamitous set of circumstances for investment markets. And I think it would actually provide a good buying opportunity, because even though there's a lot of bad news on the marketplaces, I don't think many stocks around the world necessarily reflect all of the bad news. So I think that's the one risk that really is bothering us at this stage. Whether it comes to pass or not remains to be seen. We're not that worried about China. China will grow at whatever China wants to grow at. We think that the Americans have probably got their situation more under control. So Europe really remains our leading concern at this stage.
Paul, thank you very much for your time. We look forward to seeing you on a more regular basis, sir. Paul Stewart from Plexus.